But wait, there's more. Just a couple of days ago, I created a video talking about pedophilia with the intention of clarifying the discussion. Now, people pointed out, and rightly so, that I only covered one half of this debate. I talked about people who were hating on pedophiles and mistaking them for child molesters. And they asked why I hadn't covered the other side of this issue, which is talking to the pedophiles and all of that. Well, that's because this video is being made here and now for you. This is the other side of the coin. This is where I talk about the other half of those issues. Now, first off, I'm going to start by addressing any pedophiles that may be watching this. If you are an offender, we're already done. You should turn yourself into the police as quickly as you can, stop any offenses you're doing, and get help. But turning yourself into the police is the important step here. You need to be stopped. Now, if you're a non-offender, because we've gotten that out of the way now. If you're a non-offender, and you are one of those people who doesn't want to offend, and you are horrified by the thought of molesting a child in real life, then I'm still on your side. But there's things you need to do, which is first and foremost, understand that people are going to hate you for what you are. And though what I said in my first video stands true, that it's not really fair for people to just hate you because you're a pedophile, even though you've done nothing wrong, you must understand that to them it is fair because of the possible consequences of your desire. And a lot of people are not going to be able to separate these things, wherein your pedophilia, even though you don't want to offend, to them is going to say that you do. And honestly, you can't entirely blame them. This is a pretty horrifying subject for most people to even think about. And the thought of a child being molested is horrifying. I'd imagine to pretty much everybody out there. So don't become incredibly upset or offended when someone comes at you with this attitude of, I hate you for who you are. Understand, you don't have to like it. Don't get me wrong, don't just take it and sit down and be like, yes, sir. But understand where it's coming from and understand that there is grounds for this, even if it is not specifically applicable to you. Second thing I have to tell is that if you're not offending and you don't want to offend and all of that, good for you, but that's not quite enough. You need to honestly evaluate yourself. How strong are you as a person? And if there's any doubt at all, period, then you need to go talk to a therapist. And I'll say this. Quite honestly, even if there is no doubt, you probably should be talking to a therapist. You or somebody seeking help of some kind to at least talk about these issues, because prevention is far better than the consequences here. There's no way, shape, or form to this. The entire point of all of this, not just for the people on the other side of this, but for you too, pedophiles, is to prevent child molestation. And you need to be a part of this. You need to be a part of the discussion, and you need to, in your own personal life, be a part of this. And I mean that in the way that you must take whatever steps are necessary, regardless of cost, to make sure you don't offend. Ever, no matter what it takes. And I know that might call for some pretty rough things from you, potentially. Outing yourself, maybe even. Who knows? I don't know the situations. I'm not even going to attempt to speculate. But the costs, to me at least, and again, I'm not a pedophile, but I'm speaking here as just an empathetic person. There is no cost great enough to be paid to prevent the harming of a child. They don't have control over what you do to them. You do. You have the control, and you have the power to stop it. You can choose whether or not you act on it. And if your issue is so strong that you are having problems controlling it, then get help. There is help out there. And let's talk about that. People might be afraid to go talk to a therapist because, well, what if they tell the police on me or something and I'm just trying to get help as a non-offender? Well, let me clarify that. If you are afraid, just remember there's doctor-patient confidentiality. This exists to protect you. And the doctor. This exists to protect what you tell them in the strictest of confidence so that people who might be pedophiles or have other issues can feel free to talk to a therapist. With that in mind, they will tell on you if you confess that you are molesting or are about to molest. If you let them know that you are in immediate danger, they will tell the police. And please, don't get me wrong, this is not me trying to encourage you to lie to your therapist. If you are that much of a danger, then you should tell them, and they should act, and you should be responsible enough to know that this is right. And a third, broader point for the pedophiles here is don't put yourself in a position where you could offend. Like, don't become a daycare worker if you are a pedophile. Know better than that. Society cannot regulate this because we don't know. And any attempts to say that all pedophiles can't do X or Y won't work. However, know what you are. Know that you are a pedophile, and that if you are working around children or something, you could be a danger to them. I'm not saying you will be. That's not the point here. I'm not saying you will ever molest them. I'm just noting that, one, the possibility exists, and two, if you're ever found out to be a pedophile in this position, you will be crucified. And both of these points are equally important because, one, you could molest them, let's say, even if you say you're not going to. This is a hypothetical to everyone. Someone could do it. And even if you don't molest, even if you won't molest and never will, know that if it is discovered that you are a pedophile working with children, legally or not, someone's going to try to destroy you. Just know this. So don't put yourself in that position for both of these reasons. Whether it be for their protection or yours or both, it should be you don't put yourself in this position. I've used the example in comments of you don't want an alcoholic managing the bar. And the reason is he might be a fully recovered alcoholic, right? Never gonna do anything. And in fact, he may only have the disposition to be an alcoholic due to his family traits and may have never drunk. But why are you gonna take the chance? Or why are you gonna put him in that position of temptation? Or put yourself in it if we're talking about you, the pedophile. Why would you put yourself in that position? It can't end well. And quite honestly, you all have to meet the other side halfway. Maybe this isn't exactly fair, what I'm advocating, that you should just stay away from these jobs. But like I noted before, people's concern here is real. And quite honestly, it's valid because of the mere possibility of child harm. So part of meeting people here halfway is gonna be you not putting yourself in a position where you can be even perceived to be a danger. Now, this is a form of discrimination. I'm quite aware of that. It is discrimination. But this is discrimination that has a purpose behind it, and it's for the betterment of society. You could say we discriminate against the blind or the extra elderly by not allowing them to drive, but this is a quite honest and natural and good discrimination because they're a threat. And maybe not all of them are a threat. That's the thing. Not all of these people in this group will be a threat. We draw a line well before that, wherein you're too badly sighted to drive. And maybe you can argue that. Maybe you can say that in my case, I can. But the law doesn't work that way. And nor does people's expectations. You can't say I'm the one exception and honestly expect just the average person to believe it. You have to meet them halfway, like I've said. You have to say that maybe they're wrong, but I can understand why they would think this. And at least for the time being, I'm gonna back off this one. Pick your battles here. That's not one you're gonna win. Another point for you people is that if you're gonna sit there and try to argue things like age of consent needs to be torn down, or you're gonna try to argue that, well, maybe this isn't always bad, or something to that regard, or in any way start trying to justify or take steps that move towards allowing sexual relations between adults and minors, you're going to instantly and totally, completely screw yourself for good. Because one, it's not right, and if you start arguing this, you're going to lose me as a supporter. Furthermore, you're going to lose anyone who supported you before by arguing that, because even though I'm standing here saying that people shouldn't discriminate against you unduly, when you start talking about, well, maybe we should be allowed to touch children, or anything that suggests that line of logic, even if you don't mean it, you're screwing the pooch altogether. Because this is not and cannot be an attempt to normalize pedophilia or especially child molestation. Pedophilia should not be something that gets you killed, but nor should it just be something that he's a pedophile. Great. You should be getting some help for this. You should accept that this is not a positive influence in your life. You can't say it's a good thing that someone is a pyromaniac, nor can you say it's a good thing that you're a pedophile. I'm sorry, you can't say that. You can say it is who you are, that you can't help the desires your brain gives you, that you shouldn't be derided for being a pedophile on its own. But when you bring up these other issues that basically tell people that you actually want to act on these desires, then that's what they're going to assume you want to do. Even if you're trying to bring up, like, the age of consent issue as a legitimate debate separate to this whole issue, no one's seeing it that way. You brought up the pedophilia issue, and then you talk about this, well, you want to molest children. And quite honestly, I can see the A to B to C they're using, whether it's real or not, whether it applies in that case or not. It's there, and you can see it, and you have to understand that other people will see. And quite honestly, if you are trying to advocate any ideas that would make it okay for the molestation of children in any way, then you are wrong. You should be stopped, and people should deride you for that. And if you've stuck with me this far, non-offender, then I only have one other thing to tell you here while I've got your attention. Be accepting of the people who are against you. Tolerate them. for their own hatred of you. Don't turn against them and say, well, I hate you too, or turn against them back with any kind of hatred. Accept that they hate this, and that they may hate you. And, you know, defend yourself if you're attacked, or at least avoid a situation that's bad, but just understand that the only way you're going to get people to accept you at all, even a little bit, whatever acceptance can be won, the only way you're going to get it is by being a model citizen. And more than that, by accepting and tolerating those who are against you, and not turning into whatever they accuse you of being. Don't lash out at them with hatred. Ignore them if you have to. Address their concerns with a level hand if you can. And at worst case, simply tell them that you mean no harm and walk away. Now for any non-pedophiles out there. This is an addressing really quickly of a few concerns that people had. The first one I addressed, I believe, by making this video, the counterpoint to my first one. The concerns about people wondering, where am I telling pedophiles what they need to be doing, or why am I not standing up to child molesters? Well, I hope this has done something to tell you how I feel in that regards. Another concern people have had here is this idea of executing things in fantasy and that actually meaning an intent in reality. I've seen this a few times in different places where people say that having fantasies about something necessarily means that it is something you want to do in reality. It's kind of like saying that someone who has in their disposal a simulated representation of an event and then plays through that simulated representation of an event that they want to do the event also in real life. Now, how this doesn't work is, let's say you have, magically enough, a holographic representation of a minor that is in no way real, but is holographically real. You get my distinction. If a person commits sex acts on this non-sentient, non-pain-feeling hologram, could you then argue that that is going to be training for the real event? I mean, potentially you could, right? But here's where it falls apart. The video game analogy kicks in. It rears its ugly head by saying that every person who plays Doom is not a shooter. Every person who plays dance games is not a good dancer, nor do they want to dance in real life. Guitar Hero. How many people play Guitar Hero and then decide to pick up the real guitar? Not many. The point is that for most people, and I would dare say almost everyone, fantasy is an outlet and nothing more. Where people do not take their fantasies and say that, hey, I enjoyed this fantasy, I'd better go do it now, at least in the context of a lot of fantasy. Whether it be through laziness, like with the guitar one, or being horrified by the outcome of it in real life, like with the child molestation issue. And you can't make the special exception argument that pedophiles are different from every other group that I'm talking about. Well, the people playing Doom aren't the same. Well, no, you can't really make that argument because you're ignoring the core essence of human nature, which is that everyone has the ability to distinguish reality and fantasy short of complete mental breakdown. And that with that distinction comes the ability to classify a desire as a desire for reality or a desire for fantasy only. This is a distinction we can all make, where, to use a good personal example real quick, there was a time where I worked a really crappy job, and I thought about maybe I should just kill one of my coworkers. They piss me off all the time, and I could just strangle them, right? Well, I didn't want to strangle them in real life. That's the kicker. None of my sometimes sadistic thoughts of that action were ever intended or planned out in any real execution. I never wanted to hurt anybody, despite the fantasy being there. The execution into reality did not happen, and nor did I want it to. And this is an important distinction to understand, because it exists, and it does apply in this argument more than many others even. Because this is where the distinction between the pedophile and the child molester lies. I hope this has gone some ways to clear up the confusion of my position on this issue, or to clear up people who are wondering, where is my response to the pedophiles themselves? Well, here it is, and this is the other side of the coin that I started. And I'm almost done with this topic, but I've got one more video to follow up with. This one is going to be talking about the consequences of pursuing this issue without a dialogue and through ignorance instead of through understanding and knowledge and cooperation. I'm going to tell you what happens when we take the approach that I was talking about in my first video and run with it. I'm going to tell you exactly what can happen when we choose to not have an honest discussion about this topic. Just something to think about.